everyone. Welcome to the on-chip variation session of Langtime. So this is the session where we now start digging deeper into what goes into FIMOF. How can we make sure that all the effects that slow down or make a device faster on chip are captured in runtime. So I talk about operating conditions a bit. Then there's a command. There's an option to operating conditions in runtime called analysis mode. I'll talk about what types of analysis modes are there. And then there's one analysis mode called on-chip variation, which is used very extensively across industry. It is actually till 65 nanometer, I would say it was the fastest standard for FIMOF. But now things are changing as we go still smaller. But we focus on on-chip variation. It's very important technique to model the on-chip variation. We will see how. So on-chip variation, in short form, it's famously called OCV. So we will see how does setup checking and hold checking equations get changed with OCV in place. We'll look at a concept called CRPR, which is clock reconvergence persistence removal, and then we will look at the rest of the FIMOF methodology, is that what all forms part of FIMOF, what we need to check, and then I'll introduce a very interesting concept called path-based analysis. So let's let's review the operating conditions. We see that operating conditions are PVT. We already know that. P is the process relating factor. This value is related to scaling of device parameters depending on whether the fabrication process is resulting into a faster device or a slower device. So again, S, if it's SS, it's both NMOS and PMOS are slower. If it's FF, means both NMOS and PMOS are faster compared to the nominal value. Now, the important thing to understand here is that earlier in older technologies, this process factor used to be actually a scaling factor, in the sense that there used to be just one library for a, let's say, typical process. And if you wanted to model a faster process, you typically multiplied the delays by a number less than one. If you wanted a slower process, you typically multiply the delay by a number greater than 1. So this was in fact a scaling factor, but in present day we have all over the industry we are using one library for a particular process. We do not scale. So in deep submicron, we've seen that fabrication has seen that it is not a linear scaling. So they choose to, the library guys choose to characterize timing. When I say characterize, that the process involves running 5 minutes and getting capped in the delay. So now process, there is nothing called process scaling factor. Let's say for an SS corner at any voltage or temperature, there will be one library. At FF corner, there will be one library. So, if you want to do FF analysis, you read the FF library. If you want to do SS analysis, use the SS library. But we are not using scaling now. We are not using one library and deriving the SS and FF numbers of the process. We have the numbers for process available in single file, right? So we have different files for each process. Then it's the ambient temperature. The temperature will affect delay, and this temperature is not. The first, there are two things here to consider. In fact, in process also, there are two, in all process voltage and temperature, there are two things to consider. One is at a chip level basis. That means, for example, when you talk about temperature, so one temperature comes from the specification. That's it. Let's say we say that our chip should work from temperature range minus 40 to 125, or 0 to 125. That is one factor to consider. So that will make your define your extreme boundaries of the worst case corner and the best case corner. So the worst case corner becomes slow 125C and a lower voltage, right? So this lower voltage, what is this lower voltage? This lower voltage represents the let's say you have 1 volt chip and you the specification says that it should be able to tolerate up to 10% of voltage shift. So you are qualifying your chip for 0.9 to 1.1 volt. So these two corners, each for setup, for voltage, for temperature, and for process, they represent two different extreme corners. Now let's say I am doing checking at worst case corner. So I read the library which has the SS which is characterized by this lower voltage at 0.9 volt and temperature which is 125 C. Now within on this corner, this is the worst case corner for the whole chip. But what about different parts of chip? What about different cells? Are we assuming that all the cells are at their worst? Are all the cells SS, devices SS? Do all the cells get 0.9 volt? Do all the cells work at 125? No. This is the second effect I am talking about. This is called amplifier. So we are never assuming that all the cells, all the devices on this chip, they behave in a similar fashion. We do not assume that. We assume that not all devices will be faster, will be worse. And not so we will see how do we capture this effect. But again, please remember that there are two factors to operating. One, the operating condition when we talk about operating condition defines the absolute maxima or minima of a particular corner, right? This when it comes to implementation level, it defines what library you should be reading when doing STA. So at the very basic level, you should be reading one worst case corner and one best case corner. Then within that analysis, how do you capture the effects of variation across different devices? Right. So there is a fourth angle to it, which is the interconnect model type. We've already seen a best case tree or worst case tree or typical tree. This is more for pre-layout analysis where prime time needs to estimate delay. So this interconnect model type is for pre layout, so not important for post layout. Now let's see what is analysis mode. So we saw the operating condition. Now we choose the operating condition. Now let's say I have chosen a worst case condition, and now I want to see what is the analysis I want to perform. What type of analysis I want to perform? Now this is what I was talking about. You have parameters. So semiconductor device parameters can vary with conditions such as fabrication process, operating temperature, and power supply voltage. The set operating condition command specifies the operating condition analysis, which is very clear. And specifies the operating condition so that PT can use the appropriate set of parameters value in the logic library. Okay. Now after choosing the operating condition, you have to choose which of the modes you want to, which of the analysis you want to perform, either a single operating condition, on chip variation, or advanced operating condition. In case of single operating condition mode, prime time will use this single set of delay parameters for entire design based on whatever library you read, whatever PVT condition, whatever operating condition you read. What it means is that if you are reading the worst case library, worst case conditions, and you are doing a setup check, you are doing a setup reporting, all the cells, the complete path delay, data path will be worst case because it is picking up on the worst case library, it is doing delay calculation from the worst case library. Again, all the, even for hold check, all the delays would be from the same library without doing any special thing about it. So this is called single operating condition mode, where prime time will use a single operating condition to give you reports for all the timing paths, all kind of timing paths. But this does not represent the reality, because not all the devices would be slow, not all the devices will have a higher temperature, not all the devices will be having same voltage. So how do we capture this effect? This effect is captured in something called amplification mode. Now this is a conservative analysis, which allows both maximum and minimum delays to apply to different paths at the same time. This is very important. This statement is very, very important. Minimum and maximum delays to apply to different paths at the same time. I will not clarify here. I will wait for the next slide where there are good figures which explain it better. But one thing common to both single and omniparation is that we are using single label. So we are reading just one library, and by selecting OCD, we enable something which mimics the actual omniparation, right? Now, omniparation was very popular till 65, but then with deeper submicron, as we got very still smaller, 22 nanometer, 45 nanometer, and so on. It was said that this analysis is, on one hand, it is very, very pessimistic, and on other hand, it might be optimistic in some cases. So, to solve these problems, a new method was proposed by Synopsys. So it is called advanced omniparation. So we will not go deep into this advanced omniparation. It's a slightly advanced concept. So actually, there are a number of methods like this to reduce pessimism, which is OCD was pretty industry standard, but then the improvements over OCV happened in different directions, and there is one method called AOCV which was supported by Synopsys. Then again there was a tool called GoldTime by Extreme DA, and they proposed a method called POCV, parametric OCV. So Synopsys again has bought Extreme DA, and now GoldTime is also part of Synopsys. So now this POCV is also part of PrimeTime. So PrimeTime now supports AOCV and POCV both. And on the if you keep going in this direction, the SPA is getting replaced by SSTA. So SPA is getting, SPA is static timing analysis, SSTA is statistical SPA. So truly the device parameters, that the variation in device parameters is truly a statistical problem. So now we are moving towards statistical SPA. I will have one presentation where I will give some basics about SSTA, but for the lab sake, for the scope of this course, we will work on omniparation, this OCV mode. We will not work on AOCV. Just to introduce you to the concept of AOCV, AOCV will apply some factors to be some scaling factors. So OCV also has some scaling factors. AOCV, the scaling factors change depending on the logic depth of the path and on the physical distance traversed by a particular path. So it is dependent on the path length plus the number of stages there. So we will see this thing will become more, it will make more sense when we discuss about it. So this is the, there is one more analysis condition called BCWC, where you can use two libraries, min and max. But this is where we compare with what is the difference between single operating condition and OCV mode. So there are two columns here, there are two rows, setup and hold in both the cases. So let's say single, and then we'll see what OCV improves over it. So now let's assume that we are working in a big design, complex design, where a data path, for example, from register to register, a data path will, we saw an example where the data path, there can be multiple data paths from register to a register path. One of them will be longest with most critical path for setup, one of them will be shortest, it will be most critical for hold. Similarly, a clock defined on the clock port can reach registers through different paths if you have lot of muxing, lot of logic in the clock port. So for setup, the launch, so there are four type of paths now. Now we are working in post layout mode, so clock tree is also in place. So now there are four type of paths: the launch clock path, which means that the path which clock takes from the definition point to the launch clock, this is a launch clock path. Second is the data path, which is the path from clock to queue. starts with clock to queue of register 1, goes to combination logic, ends at the data pin of the capture clock. This is the data path. The third is the capture clock path, which defines the clock path from the clock definition point to the capture clock. Now we are working in post layout mode, so launch clock path will not be exactly same as capture clock path. The capture clock path can have more or less number of elements or different elements than the launch clock path. We will see a lot of this in the lab. So for setup, when is the setup going to be worst? So you, when you talk about SPA, you always take the worst case, worst possible scenario. This is how we do things, right? This is how we verify that design will work in the absolute worst condition or absolute best condition. So the launch clock path, so remember that launch clock path and data path are similar in this fashion because they form the part of the launch delay, the launch part delay. So for setup, the worse they are, the worse it is for setup check, right? So for launch clock path, prime time will take always the late clock. Late clock we here mean that it will take the longest path for the launch clock path. Maximum delay in the clock path, maximum, now late means the maximum, late here also means that if you have defined clock latency, it will take the longest late option. Also it will take the maximum delay in the clock path, late defines the latency, so it will take the late value of the latency. Maximum here again means that it will take the longest path and with maximum delay. So again you have, so we have seen before that at each node prime time will have a max transition number and a min transition number for both sides and calls. For this case it will take the maximum, that means it will take the worst transition numbers to calculate the delay, so which will result into maximum delay in clock path and single operating condition with no derating. That means derating is just scaling. There's a command called set timing derate where we scale, we can scale the path. So no derating means that it will not apply any scaling in when you select a single operating condition. Similarly, data path will take maximum delay considering the longest path on the worst condition. The situation changes for capture clock path. Now the capture clock path will be taken, it will take the early clock. So it could be this, you have set the clock latency and minus early option, if you take that plus it will take the minimum delay, shortest path and the best transitions and no derating. Hold the situation reverse, now the data path has to be fastest and capture path has to be slowest. So early clock, minimum delay, single operating minimum delay, no derating. For capture clock path it is late clock and maximum delay in the clock path. Now consider the case that you have a very very simple design where let us say the clock to assume for simplification sake that the clock to launch and capture clock have the same path, exactly same path, there is no difference. So you could say that there is a single buffer, so you have a clock tree and the last the one buffer drives both the launch path and the capture path. And let us say the data path is very simple, you have a clock to queue and the combination path is very simple, it is only one path, there are no multiple paths. So it is just, let us say there is a series of buffers, that is it, there are no other paths. Now in this case there will be a very little difference between the type of delay calculation done for setup and type of delay calculation done for hold. Why? Because there is no difference between a late clock and an early clock, and we assume you have no clock latency in case. There is no difference, virtually no difference between a late clock and an early clock, or there is no difference between a maximum delay of a data path and a minimum delay of a data path. There will be slight difference between the transition calculation which will affect the delays to some extent, that will be the only difference. So single operating condition assumes that all the cells in the path delay are have the same operating condition, which you have read only one operating condition, and you cannot steal any paths, right? So in effect if you try to see it match it with the what happens on chip is that all these cells are now operating at the worst condition if you are reading the worst case format, even for whole chip, right? Now this doesn't really match up with the on chip variations that take place. That is why the OCV mode was introduced to capture these effects well. Now the most important thing in OCD mode is that we apply something called a timing delay. We apply a scaling factor. So what we do is that we say that okay, now data path will change. So you can apply a scale, different scaling factor for data path, for clock path, for nets, for cells, and so on. We will see an application in the lab. So we mean to say is that we apply, we tell that okay, in a particular operating conditions, let's say worst-case operating conditions, we already know that all the cell delays are at their worst, right? So we say that okay, for worst case operating condition, this will remain as it is, but it may happen that some of these cells in the data path can be slightly better than the worst case condition, slightly better. They are not SS. Maybe one device is not completely slow, it can be faster than the other, right? Not all the devices in a particular path will behave in a similar fashion. So we say that okay, if you want to delay the path further, you cannot delay it because you are already at worst case operating condition. But we can make, if the cell by any chance is faster, then it will be faster by a maximum, let's say 10%. So we say that if you want for faster cells, use a deleting factor of 0.9. Now what it does is that again it will take the worst case scenario where all the delays in the launch clock path per second and data path will be deleted by that factor, by the late deleting factor. Now if you are choosing a worst case controller, absolute worst case controller, this late deleting factor can be 1, right? You can set it to be 1, or in fact if you set it to be more than 1, let's say 1.1. So that what it means is it will delay the path, each of the path, by 10% more. So it will add 10% more delay to the absolute delay. But on the other hand, for capture clock, it will make it come early, still earlier, by applying the delay factor. Now let's say you chose the early delay to be 0.9. So it will make the clock a bit earlier, and in hold is the other way around. It will now make the data path, the complete data path, come a little bit earlier based on the what is the early deleting, and the capture clock will now be late. This is, I understand this is a bit confusing, but let's now see how do we in the next few slides will explain on this further. They will re-explain some things to make it clear. So for min-max delay calculation, so this is the set timing delay is the unique command to OCD mode. Now we will not worry about the single operating condition mode. We will only consider OCD mode for our explanation, and we will work on this mode now from further on. So operating command defines the operating condition, and there is an option called analysis mode where we specify what is the analysis mode, whether it's single or OCD. By default it will by default we see that it chooses single operating condition mode. This can change from version to version. I have seen that the newer version will take the OCD mode as default. Using this mode, we need to perform multiple analysis runs to handle multiple operating conditions. We have seen this. Typically we need to analyze at least two operating conditions, the best case and the worst case. In OCD mode, so this OCD mode, important, very important, it's a very very conservative analysis that allows both minimum and maximum delays to apply to different paths at the same time. So we have seen that it applies for setup check the data path, it will make it work, still work. For hold check, it will make the data path come earlier, less worse. That means that it allows both minimum and maximum delays to apply to different paths at the same time. Let's see. Why do we do such conservative analysis? Because of this, the process and environmental parameters may not be uniform. They are not uniform across different portions of the data. Not all the devices are. So let's say you are working in best case operating condition, you cannot assume that all the devices are open. Some of the devices will be slow, right? Some of the devices will get a lower voltage or higher voltage or lower temperature or higher temperature. Besides the variation in the process parameters, different portions may also see power supply voltage depending on the IV drop and temperature difference. These differences can arise due to many factors, IR drop, VT variations. Not all devices have plain VT. If you learn about the fabrication process, you must have learned about it, and you see that how the VT is set by the it's set by the processor behind implantation, and behind implantation cannot be same for all the devices. So some devices have, there is a slight change in VT, but the problem about VT is only a small change is needed to make a good enough variation in the delay, right, and the power. Channel length variation, we saw that the channel length is a random channel length will be a random problem. Channel length will depict the Gaussian distribution average around the technology parameter value. So let's say for 65 nanometers, the average will be 65 nanometers, but a lot of devices will have channel lengths slightly lower or slightly higher than that. Temperature variations due to local hotspots. Hotspots means the areas where the power consumption is more, and correspondingly the temperature rises. Interconnect metal edge. For interconnect each of the metal layers, there is a specified thickness. But there can be again variations in fabrication process. So all these effects come under this heading, on chip variation. And this OCV method is very, very. We apply a conservative method to make sure that we are modeling all these effects that are seen on chip in terms of the timing calculation. So now let's look at a diagram and see that how OCV handles setup tech. Now let's say now the derate is where is the derate value? Okay, so fine. Let's say we set some derate, and because of that derate, so the maximum derate would be more than 1, and the minimum derate would be less than 1. So now let's see this logic, where this is the clock. So this part is the clock launch path, this part is the data path, and this path is the clock capture path, right? So first let's just understand this, why this is a launch path, because this is a launch clock, and the clock reaching here is the launch clock. The clock reaching at the capture clock, this is the capture path, clock capture path. Now see what happens to the, now one important thing is that this part of the clock is common to both launch and capture. Right, one thing, please note this thing here. We will see how this, what significance does it hold later on. And now this path, this launch clock path, now first thing is that this launch clock path is anyway different from the launch capture path after the common point, right. So anyway they are going to have different delay. Now let's say we have applied a delay of 1.1 for maximum, 1.1, and let's say we have applied 0.9 for minimum. So what it will do is that it will take whatever delay is here in this section, the launch, and it will multiply it by 1.1 for setup chip. For data path again, whatever delay is there from C clock to Q plus combination, it will apply, it will multiply by 1.1. And now when it captures this path, this capture path, it will multiply by 0.9. It will make the capture edge come under. Right, so this is what it's mentioned here. Launch clock path is maximum, max data path, and minimum and earliest delay for the capture clock path. You can also apply derates to the checks. These are delays. T setup is not, unless and until you do something special, T setup remains as it is, because it is not a delay, it is just a timing check for the particular clock. You can also, although there are ways to derate this also, right, but you will not go into that. Just make sure that you understand that the launch clock path and the data path will get delayed, and the capture clock path will become less, will it will come earlier. So this is the in the example, the setup timing check does not, condition does not include any OCV setting for derating delay. Okay, yeah, that's what I was mentioning. The setup timing check does not include any OCB setting for derating delay. That means the check, nothing happens to the check. P set at 0.35 remains as it is. Prime time does not do anything on it because it is not part of the, it is not part of the delay. It is a check. So unless and until we do something special about it, it is not going to modify this thing. So this is the equation now. Launch clock path plus max clock path, max data path forms the part of the path delay. It should be less than or equal to, the equation is modified now. It should be less than or equal to clock period plus capture clock path minus T setup, right? Earlier when we were considering ideal clocks, these two things were not there. These two things were absent, the launch clock path and the capture clock path, and the equation, this is now a very familiar equation, max data path less than or equal to clock period minus T setup. This is all what we have been studying till now. But now in post layout the clock paths become different, right? So we need to capture that effect somehow. In pre layout we capture this effect by the use of set clock uncertainty, but in post layout we have actual delays available. So this equation gets modified and the clock delays come into play here, right? So the minimum clock period, this is how you can rearrange the equation and calculate what is the minimum clock period. Is launch clock path plus max data path, it should be a minus minus capture clock path, and yeah, plus T setup. Now this is from the figure, it is putting some values. What is the launch clock path? Is launch clock path is 1.2 plus launch clock path is 1.2 plus 0.8, data path is 5.2, the capture clock path is 0.86, T setup is 0.35. So this is, it is calculating, doing some calculations here. So we are calculating the minimum clock period. Yes. Now this statement is very important. The part delays correspond to the delay values without any OCB derating, and we have to derate using these functions. This is the way, this is the command that we can use to derate. Please remember, OCB without derating at a single operating condition doesn't make a lot of sense. So whenever you are doing timing analysis, you have to make sure certain things. What operating conditions you have read in? Have you selected the on-chip aleration mode? Yes. Last thing, apply timing delay. Now one question, how do I come up with these values, right? So these values are usually calculated, there are some backend tools, there are backend tools who do post, who do place and route. They have a method, they have a way of calculating these delays for you. So usually they come from the backend team for a particular technology, right? So these are not arbitrary numbers, and in fact these numbers will be different for cell, for net, for clock. So the clock, so the clock tree is a very, of a very uniform kind of nature. That means there are some particular types of cells which are only used for clock tree. So usually clock tree has a tighter limit on variation, and data path, since it's combination with data path, there are any number of cells will be used, number of types of cells will be used, so the variation band becomes a little wider compared to clock. So usually I have seen that the data derates values are much wider, much more than the clock derate values, right? So this is how setup check is performed. So again, three things: proper operating condition, selecting the on-chip variation mode, and setting the proper derates. These three will make you help you in doing proper OCB, proper checking, proper modeling of the on-chip variation. Now let's see. Other OCB analysis is at worst PVT condition. So if the setup timing check is being performed at the worst case PVT, no derating is necessary on the late path, as they are already the worst possible. This is again important. This is why the timing derate late is 1, and the derate early is 0.9 or less than 1. So this is just please take a while to understand this concept, that we are already at the worst case operating condition. So why make the data path still have more delay? The cells are already at their worst delay, they cannot have more delay. So the timing delay for the late will be 1, earlier yes it will be less than 1. So the rate specification on the capture clock path can be something like this, the long clock. So this is just different way of saying that your late derates will always be 1, or worst case operating should be 1. In fact, many people will slightly delay depending on. So many times it may happen that the worst case corner that you have might not be the absolute worst case corner. So some people will still put some delays with the greater than one for the most case. So depends, totally depends on what technology library you are following, what technology you are working in, what is the sign of flow. So these things are not set in stone. They vary from even from division to division in the same company depending on the history of the chips. So it all comes down to yield. How many chips after manufacturing do not pass your tests, right? So it all comes down to yield. Okay, now let's see the hold. Hold is the other way around. Once you understood setup, hold is the same thing. The only difference being that the launch clock path will be minimum, this will be minimum, and this will be minimum, and the capture clock path will be maximum. The equation now becomes, earlier the equation was that total path delay should be greater than the hold timing check. Now the equation becomes that launch clock path plus the path delay should be greater than the capture clock path plus the hold time, right? So this is 0.85 plus 1.7. Which is, this is 0.85 plus 1.7 minus 1, which is the capture clock path, and minus 1.25, which is the hold tech, should be greater than 0. Yes, so this equation is just rearranged. So idea is this should be greater than this one. So this is again we apply this, how you apply timing delay. And if and ever you want to derate the timing check, that is the T setup and T hold values, you can use this one on set timing derate minus cell check. Just a caution here. This is where I think it is. I do not recommend doing this. I do not recommend using early value. Now in this case, to be on the safe side, to be on the more conservative side, ideally I would not like to change the values of T setup and T hold. That is, I would not like to make them lesser. The higher the value of T setup and T hold, the more conservative is your analysis, right? They are check values, not the delay values. So in any condition, I would not like to have the check value which is lower than what is given in the library, right? So I will never apply a minus early value. If you want to make it more conservative, apply the late value, but don't apply any early value, right? Many people, what they do is they make the mistake of assuming that the check value, let's say the T hold here. Many people assume that it will get the same delay as the early here, as the data path here, but it is not true. T hold and T setup are the checks, they are the boundaries. If you reduce this value, the window during which this time the data should be stable around the clock is reduced. So you are not in safe territory now. You are playing with the values, you are making the values less, you are making it less conservative. So if you give a minus cell check option, don't give a minus late option unless and until you are very, very sure that you want to make it less conservative. Right? Be careful, understand the difference between the cell check and without this option, that is the cell delay. Right? This is a cell check, not a cell delay. Okay, now let's come to CRPR. I will just explain what is the significance of CRPR. Now we have seen that there is something called a common clock path. Right, this is the common clock path, which is common to both the launch clock and the capture clock. Now, by default, what prime time does is that when you see a report timing command, it will start with the clock network, the clock, it will give a clock launch path, it will give data, it will give a clock capture path. What prime time by default will do, it will apply whatever derate values we have given to everything. It will derate this part. It will derate this part. So for the launch clock path, ideally common clock path should not get derated. Why? Because this is common to launch and capture, and if you apply derates onto it, what it will mean that this path will have more delay in launch and less delay in capture. It cannot happen physically. this is the same two cells cannot in a one single cycle in one timing check, they will not have different delays, they should not have different delays, it is physically not possible. So it will apply the rates, prime time will apply the rates, but then it will give you credit. What will it will do? It will say that okay, there is something called CRPR, clock reconvergence pessimism removal. So clock reconvergence pessimism is the effect of derating the common clock path, and removal step is the one that removes this pessimism. That means it will first it will derate this path. For example, this path length is x, right? This path length is x. In launch, let's say the derates are 1.1 and 0.9. So the launch, let's say the x is just the delay for the common clock path, not the complete path. So in the launch for setup, let's say I am talking about setup. In launch, the delay will become 1.1. In capture, the delay will become 0.9x. CRPR, what it will do, it will give you back this difference. This difference is 0.2x. So in the end of the timing report, you will see a row which says that clock reconvergence pessimism removal, and it will give you back the pointer. So whatever it will reduce, if your slack is negative, it will increase your slack value by this amount. So this is why this happens is that the CRPR calculation by default prime time will do launch clock path and capture clock path, right? It's easier for it because it will. Now for CRPR, so calculating CRPR, prime time needs to understand for every path, for every timing path, the common clock path keeps on changing. So calculation of CRPR is a very compute intensive job. So if CRPR is enabled, the timing analysis will take more time. This is why it's a separate step. So CRPR is accuracy limitation that occurs when two different clock paths partially share a common physical, and this shared segment is assumed to have minimum delay for one path and maximum delay for another path. This condition can occur anytime the launch and capture paths use different delays in terms of when we apply set timing derate command and we are in OCD mode. Automated correction of this inaccuracy is called CRPR. There is an example where, see, this is the way we have selected analysis type to be on separation. So this is the library min and max. In our case, when we will do timing analysis, we will have only one library here. Set timing derate early. Now when we report timing minus delay and minus, so this is the common point. So this is where the delays are written. So this is the min delay 0.64, this is the max delay. Now the cell here is showing us different delays. So this cell is common to both the launch and capture, and it is showing different delays, which is wrong. So prime time will give the credit of 0.8 minus 0.64 back to you at the end of the timing report. So this is the report timing. So clock network delay propagated. So this is important. Propagated means, let's so that we reports obviously you understand. Propagated means we have set propagated clock on this, and we are in post payout mode. So this is where prime time gives back. So here the difference is 0.16, 0.8 minus 0.64. This is where prime time gives back. So propagated delay is 7.16. This is a setup check. If the clock comes earlier, then it's a problem. If the clock comes later, it's good for you. So this 7.16 clock now comes a bit later, so it's good for setup. It's a credit, not a debit, right? So if this 0.16 was not there, the slack would have been, but the value is I think 1.92 minus. So the slack is increased by this value, 0.16 value. This is to remove the inaccuracy that is there present in the delay calculation when we are using OCD and set timing delay, right? So this is one more example where there can be clock reconvergence. Now in this case is a problem. Why? Because the let's see this. Now what is the launch clock path? So if there is no case analysis setting on this mark, on this particular marks, the clock launch path will be the longest. So the clock launch path will be something like this, right? The clock capture path would be something like this. So please remember this TP, actually this TP is same as this one. So this actually the figure should be like this. So this without even so the but the point is that this mux will have some value 0 or 1, right? And it should not this is a wrong case where you have a mux logic in your clock path and you have not set anything on it, and prime time is taking longer path for one case and shorter path for other case. In all probability this is not correct. So what you should do here is that you should set some case analysis on the mux, some proper case analysis on the mux, and select either this path or this path. So this is one case where there is a reconvergence. Reconvergence means that the clock is getting diverged here and the clock is converging here, it is reconverging. So you have to make sure you select only one path. So these are the problems that come during clock path logic designing, where you have lot of muxes, lot of cases where some other clock will be taken for test mode, or a divide by two clock will be taken for time, and so on. So there are a lot of cases where you have this problem, and you have to make sure that all such cases you set proper case analysis. Right? This is where case analysis becomes important, to select a particular mode for timing analysis. If you don't do that, then you have big violations. Why? Because the clock path itself is, there are so much variation in the clock path itself. Right? Now let's talk about sign off methodology. So what do we do as part of sign off? So STA can be run for many different scenarios. The three main variables, PVT corner we have seen, operating mode is OCV, we apply OCV, and the third is parasitic corner. What is the RC interconnect corner, right? So let's see the parasitic interconnect corner. We have never seen in the of this course, we have never mentioned this one. So parasitic interconnect corners are governed by the variations in metal bricks in the manufacturing process. So I've already mentioned that there are separate tools that will do the extraction. That means that will calculate the value of R and C from the layout. So one is for typical, where nominal values of interconnect resistance and capacitance are extracted. Other is max-C, where the capacitance is max, min-C, where the capacitance is minimum, max-RC, where the RC is maximum, min-RC, where both R and C are minimum. So usually one of these corners is selected. So usually what will happen is that worst case clock corner will be now worst PVT plus probably max RC, and the best case corner would be min, the best case condition, whatever the FF and the higher voltage and lower temperature, plus a corner where the combination of R and C gives the least delay. So probably this corner results in smallest delay for fast and short mode, so and can be used for min path analysis. So apart from knowing the operating condition with PVT, you should also know what is the worst corner for parasitic. Usually again this comes from the back end team, from the people who are doing back end. A front end engineer might not know about this, so it comes from the back end usually. So then comes the operating mode. So you have selected now let's say you have selected a worst case corner plus a parasitic corner which gives you worst delay. Now for that operating condition on parasitic corner, in a full chip you might need to do so many modes: functional, high speed clocks, functional 2, functional 3, functional 4, scan 1, scan 2, BIS, JTAG. This is where STA becomes such a big problem. It becomes so much compute intensive. That means for each operating condition, so let's say you have, so the chip I was working on, it had 6 operating conditions, 2 for setup, 4 for hold, right? In fact all 6 we have to make sure setup and hold is needed for all the cases. Now for the 6 operating conditions, we have 3 functional modes and we have 3 test modes. What it means is that, so 6 operating conditions, into 6 modes. So this is called PVT is called operating condition, this is corner or condition, operating mode is whether it is function or test. So we have 6 corners and 6 modes, that makes it 36 runs. We have to run prime time 36 times. Each of these will have individual corner and individual mode. So one mode will be functional mode 1 and worst case operating condition 1. Other would be functional mode 1, worst case operating mode 2. So I have 2 worst case corners and 4 best case corners. So this is where STA becomes much more challenging, right? In corner based STA, the number of corners keeps on increasing with the technology getting more and more complex. It is very difficult to define one absolute worst case or absolute best case corner. There can be more than one, there are more than one. So as an STA engineer, if you want to sign off your chip, you have to run 36 corners and you have to make sure that your timing does not violate in all such corners and modes, right. So PVT corners dictate at what condition the STA analysis takes place. So this is the combination I was talking about. These are modes and these are corners. Usually I am not worried about typical. Typical lies between best and worst, right. You can have multiple best case and multiple worst case corners. So I hope you now appreciate the challenges that lie for an STA engineer. So the biggest challenge is to verify everything in so many cases. There are 36 cases what I am listed here, right. Okay, now let's move ahead. Again I will review the transition propagation, it is a very important concept. So there is an AND gate, there is a timing arc from A to O and B to O. The problem is of slew calculation at Z, slew is nothing but transition. Does it use a slew from A or B? So at Z, so let's say A is arriving late but B has a worse slew value, which output slew should prime time propagate? That means should it, now at Z prime time can only have one max value and one min value. It cannot have a value which is dependent on A or dependent on B. It cannot have, let's say there are 5 pins here, 5 input pins, still the output pin will have one max value and one fall value for each rise and fall. It can only choose one of the transitions of all the 5 inputs. It will not store all the values. This type of analysis is called graph based analysis. This is the default analysis that prime time performs. Whatever report timing you do, whatever in post layout mode or pre layout mode, the type of analysis which you are doing by default is called the graph based analysis, right. And it just depends, there is one variable to control whether it should take the worst transition value among all the inputs or it should take the transition value for the worst available time. Use this always, this is the default, use the worst value, don't use the worst arrival time, it becomes optimistic sometimes. So default is the worst case slew. Worst arrival slew, as I told before, can be optimistic and should not be used. Prime time will only keep one rising and one falling transition at any given point. 4 is an OCD mode. 4 by 4, rise max, rise min, fall max and fall min, 4 values in OCD mode, because one is max and one is min because of the timing delays. One is max and one is min. If it didn't do this, a pin at the end of logic cone will have 1000 of possible transitions because of the number of stages. So let's say you have 3 stages here. These are not buffers, there are some generic stages with multiple inputs. Let's say with multiple inputs, right. Now what about the transition at this pin? It will have the transition, if prime time was supposed to store all the transition numbers there, it will have to go back a long way and it will have thousands of values like this, right. So this is why to make the analysis reasonable and make the data reasonable, not in like thousands of data per endpoint, prime time will only keep 4 in OCD mode, 4 values. So it will propagate the worst case slew to each pin and output. What it means is that The graph based analysis is very technical. That means for a particular timing path, please don't get worried if you don't understand this, you understand it with experience also. Now let's say a path register to register path at each now has a combination logic of depth 3. At each point prime time will store only the worst case value, right, for setup time. Now this worst case value might not be in line with the actual data path. So there, so this worst case value, now let's say there is some other pin which is not even in the data path, but it's driving one of the inputs of the cell and has a very bad transition. So you get bad values. So this is why we say that graph based analysis is very pessimistic, comparatively pessimistic, more pessimistic. But we have no other choice. Why? Because we cannot, prime time will not store so many values, thousands of values per input, right? Per output of the cell. So what is the, what do we do now? Now we have something called path based analysis. Path based analysis is accurate, more accurate. It is not optimistic. Please understand, it is not optimistic, but it is more accurate than graph based. And in path based, prime time will actually calculate the transition values, which is dependent on the path, which is path dependent on not generic. Please note, in graph based, the calculation of transition at the cell output is takes into account all the inputs. That means it will take the, it take into account the worst case value of all the inputs. It is not path based. It does not depend what path, what timing path we are checking. It's a generic thing. That's why it's pessimistic. But in path based, prime time will actually calculate the transition depending on what path is traversing. That is why it is called path based. And it is only used in the very end of the project where you have very small number of violations left. And it is becoming difficult to solve those violations, and you want to make sure that okay, first I have to see whether it meets in path based analysis, whether PBA will tell me that the path is meeting. If the path is meeting, I am good, I do not need to do any more testing. So because we are into more accurate mode, so important thing, only it, so slew propagation creates a pessimism on most timing paths. When there are few timing violations left, these can be run in more detail, to push the actual slew from the start point and report the revised slack. If the violations are small in magnitude, this method can indicate clean time. This is very important. It's only used for the cases where you have only few violations left and they are proving difficult to fix. How do you do PBA? The process is called recalculation. So you have a report timing, you have a, an option to report timing, I will show you in the lab. There is also a command called get timing path, which you can associate, you can ask prime time to recalculate, but don't worry about this path right now, this command right now. Get timing path is much more advanced command for some advanced analysis. But report timing has one one option where you can do, you can ask it to. So you see, you cannot do it at the complete level. You cannot say update timing in PBA mode. It won't do that. You have to do it path based. You have to give a path. So report timing you will give from and to, and you give an option which will tell prime time to recalculate the path, right? The setup and hold constraint delay will also be recalculated because they are, everything is affected by transition, right? The calculation of setup check and hold check, the path delays and so on. Everything is affected by the transition calculation. So once you ask prime time, you give a set of paths to prime time and ask it to recalculate, it will do it for you, right? But only a very small number of paths. If you again include a large number of paths for PBA, it will again take a lot of time. It might even hang, right? So this was about, so in this section we discussed about the silo strategies. So first and foremost, the most important strategy we discussed was OCD. Things will become more clear when I show you the OCD timing report in the lab. Secondly, we discussed about the conditions, operating conditions, and we discussed about the parasitic corners. We also saw what are modes. You can have functional mode, test mode, and so on. We also tried to appreciate the problem an SE engineer faces in terms of the number of operating conditions and operating modes. And we saw an interesting concept of path based analysis. So again, I'll try and include this in the lab if possible. So we saw that, so this try and understand this slide. how the transition propagation takes place, and then these two slides, transition propagation. If you understand transition propagation, how it takes place, you will understand PDF very well, right? In the next session, we will see about again, we will see an interesting concept of signal integrity and noise. So, signal integrity and noise are not part of the lab, they are slightly more complex as compared to timing. So, we will see the concept behind signal integrity and the noise calculation. So thanks a lot.